Okay. So we're here to talk about microaggressions and are they really small? I know growing up as a student in Palm Springs Unified, oftentimes kids would call me names or I would hear other kids call each other names, and I really never understood. Oftentimes I was told, oh, you'll be okay, or let it roll off your back. And little did I know that there was a technical term to it and the implications of the impact it would have on individuals or myself, even as an adult. And so there are three different types of microaggressions that we're going to talk about today, and we're really going to talk about how small are they.
So the first type is called micro assault. These are the conscious or intentional discriminatory actions, racial epithets, white supremacist symbols, etc. So these are when we're intentionally making a comment that's going to have harm on someone, like that's so ghetto, that's so retarded, that's so gay, words that will hurt.
The next one is micro invalidations, and these are the verbal and nonverbal communication that subtly convey rudeness or insensitivity and demeans another individual. Like, you're Asian, why aren't you good at math? You're acting so sensitive. Is it that time of the month? Are you sure you're gay? I bet I could change your mind. Where are you really from? And I don't even see you as black.
And the third one is micro insult. These are verbal or nonverbal attacks meant to hurt the intended victim by questioning their racial heritage or their identity. So you were born in Canada, or you have a mental disability. You seem perfectly normal to me.
So microaggressions, as defined by the Diversity in the Classroom, UCLA Diversity and Faculty Development 2014, microaggressions are the everyday verbal, nonverbal, and environmental slights, snubs, or insults, whether intentional or unintentional, that communicate hostile, derogatory, or negative messages that target persons based solely upon their marginalized group membership. So what we're
Okay,
going to,
go
sorry,
ahead.
no, you
No.
go.
So we're going to show a video while Vera pulls it up. We're going to add the Spanish subtitles so you all can follow along. And what I want you to be thinking about while you're watching the video is, are these small? Are these microaggressions small? Do they matter?
Oh, you're so pretty for a black girl.
Oh, she has a Jew nose.
Oh, your hair would look so good if it was straight.
Jews are so cheap. Why are you so cheap?
Do you speak good English?
How are you an Iraqi Jew?
I think the person saying microaggression kind of doesn't really think about it.
This person who said it was my friend, and like I was astonished they would like say something like that.
You don't want to make a big deal about it, but then it's also like you just said something that offended me, so I feel like I should speak up.
Because they're micro, because they're very subtle, they're small, you feel like you don't have a reason to be upset. You're overreacting, and people even can make you feel that way when you bring it up.
They're like, oh, you can't take a joke.
You're making too big of a deal of this.
Why are you overreacting?
Don't take it so seriously. It was just a joke. Chill out.
Say like, oh no, I actually love black people. I love people of color. Like, they try to just minimize the situation.
If someone feels hurt by a microaggression, it shouldn't just be pushed to the side.
It definitely has negative impacts and like leads to people disliking who they actually are.
Those kinds of subtle offensive comments can build up over time, and they can have like a deep psychological effect, and they can make you feel bad and they can make you doubt yourself.
We try to just use jokes to like make things less awkward or like ease social experiences, but it is important because you need to like be aware of what you're saying and like who you're speaking to.
Think of what you say and how it can affect the person you're saying it to.
So the question there, as she said at the end, is think about you, what you say and how it can affect the person you're saying it to. So as we pull the video down, does anybody want to, this is a smaller group. So if you want to add a comment, you can put it in the chat, or you can even just unmute yourself if there's anything you would like to say after that video. Anybody have any thoughts? Are they really small? Now that we know what microaggressions are and you've seen some examples. Y'all are a quiet group.
I can
and
always,
that's okay. Sorry?
I can always speak. They're not small. They definitely have an effect on people. And, you know, it's a way to, yeah, like marginalize various aspects of our personalities or physical representation. It's a way to kind of be disdainful towards you about something about who you are. It makes you feel like less of a person or not as good of a person as somebody thinks you should be. So it tends to like, yeah, grade us into different levels. So yeah, it's very hurtful stuff that seems very, very easy. It doesn't seem that big a deal, but yeah, it can build up over time. It can be very, very, very hurtful.
Thank you.
Madonna asked, do we have any data about frequency or microaggressions in the classrooms or the schools?
So that's a really good question. And sometimes they're so subtle that to collect data, I'm not even sure what that would look like, but I think that it's something we should think about moving forward. Even that self-reflection. I know when we started doing the unconscious bias, the other three-day workshop that Vera and I are a part of, I learned a lot about myself as we were presenting, you know, as I'm learning about different things and how things can be hurtful. So yeah, something to look at moving forward for sure. Vera, do you have anything to add on that?
Well, and the one thing that I can say is that before we, as a district, started going to PBIS and restorative practices, oftentimes if kids were calling other kids names, it was considered a demerit, or students would get referrals for it. And so now, because we're going more into restorative practices, I can't say that the data would definitely include any of those, because before we get to that level, we would have a restorative meeting with students, especially at the high school. And a lot of times it might be name calling, calling kids out of their name, referring to their sexual orientation, and all of those are derogatory. And before we would be able to write referrals for those, but now we are trying to bring the students together to have conversations about those things. And so I would definitely like to bring that up to ARC, the ARC committee, on ways that we could record that, especially at the elementary, middle school, and high school level.
And I'm sure it happens more a lot at the elementary level, that people think it as of teasing. So I know growing up, like people would tease me about the complexion of the color of my skin. So I would, like, you know what, every day I would go home crying and boo hoo hoo. And my mom, you know, finally she said, you know what, Mimi, you just have to tell them the black of the berry is sweeter than juice. And you know what, and I love my complexion to this day, you know, so it is something that does need to be addressed. And as like you said, Vera, at the ARC, that is something that we should definitely talk about. Amy also said they absolutely aren't small, and they have such an impact that they get piled on, especially when they're coming from people in all angles. She also said, aside from students being responsible for microaggressions and collecting data in that regard, it must also be hard to collect data on microaggressions that come from teachers and staff.
Yes, and that's something that we're going to talk about in this next slide. But the other piece of that is, just like Janelle said, and I opened up with, when it happens to you over and over again, you don't even realize, because then it becomes your normal and you don't realize the implications of it until, like, we're having conversations and I am well past elementary school, but you realize the implications of it, and not just that, but it's still happening. So here are some microaggressions that take place in the classroom. So just as it was addressed student to student, this is teacher to student. Okay, so here's your typical biology class. It's a pretty diverse group. You have a male teacher and you have a speckling of a little bit of everybody in this class. So one microaggression that often can take place, and this is something that at the high school level, we've gotten away from putting students' names up. Now it's ID numbers. And so it's a little harder to identify students, but when you are ranking your top students in the classroom, it is focusing on class rank and it intensifies a student's sense of intelligence is a fixed rate, which can also worsen stereotypes as a threat. And when I say that, if students' names were there, you would be able to attach possible stereotypes. Earlier I had used, oh, you're Asian, why aren't you good at math? Well, the converse of that would be, oh, because you're Asian, you are good in math. And so what if an Asian student's name was at the very top? Is that reinforcing that stereotype? And if comments are made, that then becomes a microaggression on top of a microaggression.
Okay, and another thing you might see in a classroom, hopefully not for much longer, but things we have seen is comments like this: class, remember your online research paper is due Friday. Gabe, you can use the computer lab at lunch. So singling out a student because maybe you know that they don't have internet or a computer at home, but right now we've given a lot of computers to all our kids, but we know that sometimes internet's an issue, even with hotspots. So just singling students out in front of other students. Maybe you do know that that student needs something extra, but we need to always be choiceful about our words to them, specifically in front of the class.
Mia, I know you had some trouble with the last lab chart, but a lot of girls have difficulty with that sort of thing. I gave you extra points because your drawing of the habitat was great. This comment right here implies that girls have difficulty with math and science and that they're better at art. So why would you give me extra credit on my art when you could have helped me possibly with the math, or you're just making assumptions that I'm not very good at it?
Well, I'll be doing pig anatomy today. Ben, why don't you do the dissection? And Amy, you can take notes. So again, just stereotyping that the boy in the class wants to do the dissection and the girl in the class doesn't, and she can just take notes. So, you know, looking at gender and what stereotypes are we as staff members or teachers or parents or admin, what are we projecting onto our kids?
Are you sure you're in the right room? This is AP biology. And you have a white male teacher and you have a student of color that this comment is directed at. And is this assuming that the student doesn't belong here because of those two things? She's female and because of the color of her skin.
Oh, Caroline, you're from Carver High. You should probably sign up for our after school tutoring program. So assuming that a student that is maybe from a lower socioeconomic area is not able to perform at the same level as maybe some of the high achievers in maybe your AP class or in any class, just making assumptions about anybody based on the way they're dressed or what neighborhood they live in.
Okay, so now we have a scenario that is hypothetical, but it is staged here in our Coachella Valley, in our district in particular. Sue?
Okay. So Juan Rodriguez is a student at a Palm Springs High School. He is one of the few transfer students in his first period class from Desert Hot Springs. Juan takes the bus to school and is tardy for his first period for the second time in a week. His teacher comments, and this comments in front of the whole class, "Looks like the Desert Hot Springs buses are late again." Some students laugh at the remark. Although he is embarrassed, Juan doesn't respond and tries to brush off the comment. After class, Juan approaches his teachers and shares how much the comment bothered him. And this bus that he was on is not a school bus. It was probably the city bus. So there's different ways that the teacher could or should respond. We're gonna look at some responses. This first one, are you sure you should be riding the bus here? Wouldn't Desert Hot Springs High School be a better fit for you?
And what kind of a response is that? Think to yourself. You know what you should do? Try getting up earlier so you can be on time.
Well, I was just really surprised that as a transfer student, you would be late so often. I thought you'd do a better job of trying to get here on time.
And the last one, oh dear, I'm so sorry, you poor thing. How awful of me. All of those responses before this last one were very demeaning, showed little empathy, and were very stereotypical and didn't give the student any consolation for, hey, what happened? So this should have been the response from the teacher or a sample of one. Sue?
Thank you for having the courage to be honest and share your feelings with me. That sounds like it hurt. I realized that being spoken to like that in front of others is demeaning and must have been hard to take. I'm sorry. A response like this has so many different positive lasting effects. First, the teacher owned it. So that teaches the student, it's okay if we make a mistake, but let's own it and make it right. It also shows, you know, some empathy for what she put the student through.
Yes, and Ms. Axum said the teacher should be asking what supports are needed in order to support the student.
Everybody has a story. All our kids are coming in with different situations at home.
And that's the one thing that, if anything, out of this equity conference that we want each and every person to take away from is empathy. Being able to put yourself in somebody else's shoes to understand where they're coming from so that you can see it through a different lens. Because oftentimes we have our own blinders on and it's hard for us. We're so caught up in our own stuff that we can't take a step in somebody else's shoes. But when we are able to and take a step back, it gives us a different perspective. And if we're not so quick to respond and answer, who knows what we may be able to get out of not just students, but staff as well. Somebody had mentioned earlier, learn how to say your staff members' names right also. Well, what if you take a step back to try and understand somebody else's point of view or perspective as a staff member? So okay.
Go ahead. Yeah. I was just gonna say, while we're, Vera's going to pull up this video and get the subtitles ready.
Identify as a Hispanic American.
Afro Latina.
Mexican American.
Chicana. Mexican.
Afro Latina.
Go for it.
Okay. Think about, why does it matter? Why does it matter what words we use and what we say to students in our classrooms or to other staff on campus or even to each other? Kidding, serious, intentional or unintentional. Think about, why does it matter? Okay.
I identify as a Hispanic American.
Afro Latina.
Mexican American.
Chicana.
Mexican.
Afro Latino.
To my family, I am Puerto Rican. To the country, I am Latina.
Growing up, I felt as though I was too Black to be Latina. And too Latina to be Black.
Chicana, I think, identifies more of the political and social values that I hold more than just where my family's from.
I don't feel pressure to be more Latino or American. I'm comfortable with who I am, like, culturally.
How can I be Mexican when I'm pressured to be more American? How can I be American when I'm pressured to be more Mexican?
My family, growing up, wanted me to, you know, stick with my Hispanic roots, but also did not want me to show those roots to the world.
A lot of the times people didn't even know that I was Cuban because I guess I don't look like your typical Cuban.
My mom is Mexican, so I always grown up with her culture, with her language, while being American doesn't come up as easily.
I've gotten people assume, even other Latinos assume that I'm white or that I'm not Latina or Chicana. It definitely hurts, but at the same time, it's not something that I can control. I think I can do my best to project that identity.
It's hilarious when you walk into a room and they don't think you're Caucasian enough. You're not American enough. You're not Latino enough.
Being Latino isn't as accepted as it should be.
It makes me feel pressured to fit a certain mold here in the United States. But now that I'm older, it's more like, it's what I make of it.
That doesn't stop me from being proud of who I am and where I'm from.
And then ultimately, I think what you settle on is how you view yourself.
We're kind of stripped in a lot of cases of our Spanish tongue and our Spanish heritage and told it's really important that you only speak English.
Because if you're from a Spanish-speaking country and you can't speak Spanish, it's harder for you to connect with the people there.
And not being ashamed when you do speak Spanish, but also not being ashamed if you weren't taught it.
Okay, so Spanish is not my first language because my parents were afraid of me being discriminated against because they were discriminated against. And now they're hurting me because I'm not Latino enough because Spanish is not my first language. But they don't know that I couldn't speak Spanish because my parents were afraid of me getting hurt.
My parents have already done all the work for me. And that's why I feel like I have like a bright future ahead of me because the work's already been done. All I have to do is like harvest what has been put on the ground.
But it's about me and other Afro-Latinos working really hard and continuing to make strides.
I feel like this country has a lot of opportunity for me.
When you have pushed another human being towards the light, towards positivity, towards a voting booth, towards using their power, you are powerful.
People are telling us as Hispanics that we don't belong here. That's kind of motivated us to join together as a Hispanic community and say, we do belong here. And despite what you're saying, I will prove to you why I do belong here.
Okay, and then we're gonna actually, while we have the videos up, go straight into another video. But again, so what we're thinking of is why does it matter? Why does it matter? Why do our words that we say matter to our students, to other staff members? And we're gonna go right into the next video and then we'll have a little open discussion. Again, thinking why do our words matter? Here we go. Thank you, Vera.
Can you say something in Spanish?
Yeah, I can.
Hablo inglés.
I do. Do you speak inglés? Why don't you speak Spanish? Why don't you speak Spanish? I mean, it's the second most used language in the world.
Are you an immigrant?
Yep, just like you and your family.
Did your parents come here illegally?
No.
Ooh, can you teach me how to dance Mexican?
Is that a TikTok thing?
Oh, you must love tequila.
Yeah, and you love plain tasting generic soda water, right?
You love Cinco de Mayo, right? I love it too.
Yeah, I do, but we don't do all this. You guys made that up.
Do you like have a really big family?
Yeah, actually I do. It's part of our plan to actually get our land back.
Is it even safe to travel to Mexico right now?
Yeah, it's just as safe as crossing the street.
I bet you cook the best tacos.
Yeah, I do. I also make a really great chicken piccata.
Why don't you like spicy foods?
Okay, because it makes my tummy hurt.
And what?
Why are you Latina women loco?
Crazy? Who's calling us crazy?
Oh, I bet you are superstitious.
And I bet you're bad luck. I'll sage later.
So what's your favorite telenovela?
Oh, you know what? My favorite one is the one where like the girl slaps the other girl because she's in love with a guy, but the guy turns out to be the girl's brother. And then turns out he was a twin.
Hey, can you like call me papi?
No.
Wait, so why are Latinos always late?
Only when we have to meet up with people we really don't like.
Makes the time shorter. Oop, gotta go.
So, what do you guys think? Why do words matter? So I can give you a example from my family, my son, who's, you know, he's got me as his mom. I'm, you know, a Jewish girl from Chicago. And then his dad is Mexican and American Indian. And he looks Hispanic. And people always comment to him that he doesn't like spicy food. And that what kind of Mexican doesn't like spicy food? And he has shared that over time, he feels like he's betraying what he's supposed to be, right? So why do our words matter? Y'all are quiet. Vera and I are just going to have to keep talking.
Is that a comment in the chat?
Yes. And Curtis said words are hurtful.
Words are hurtful. And what are the feelings behind the words? If we're saying something, especially if you're a teacher and you're saying something to a student in front of a class, and then people laugh because it's funny, and then the student affected doesn't think it's funny, but they don't want to say anything in front of people, maybe like all, over time, these really add up.
Jason said, words are the ways we navigate the world. And then Ann said, is the littles for me.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Miss Axum, I think, was going to say something.
I was just going to say that words kind of set a tone. And so as soon as you say it, it can't be unsaid. And that's going to be immediately how somebody sees you the next time. So if you have said a microaggression, like as a teacher, then that student is probably going to have a really hard time ever feeling safe around you. So it kind of has these resounding repercussions, not just in that moment, but moving forward for you and the student.
I like that. Yes.
Mm. And Janelle said words can make you defensive. So this is where sometimes maybe we start to see things that look like behavior, right? Is when somebody's reacting to really a way that they're feeling inside based on something that was said to them. Good point.
Yes.
I identify as a Hispanic American.
Afro.
Spanish?
Yeah, I can.
Hablo ingles.
For people who still.
Okay, so one thing that we use to try to make it, I mean, we've talked about it, but to illustrate what microaggressions over time can do is we show this video. And so once again, I'm gonna get the auto translate ready. And Sue, would you like to add anything to this?
Just that in this video, it really gives you a really good idea of how something that might seem innocent or not a big deal over time can become toxic.
Still don't think that microaggressions are a problem?
Oh, you're so well-spoken.
Just imagine, instead of being a stupid comment, a microaggression is a mosquito bite.
Ugh, it's a compliment.
Mosquito bites and their itch are one of nature's most annoying features. But if you're only bitten every once in a while...
No, where are you really from?
Cleveland.
Sure, it's annoying, but it's not that big a deal. The problem is that some people get bitten by mosquitoes a lot more than other people. I mean, a lot more. Whether it's on a date.
Oh, your English is so good.
Excuse me?
Going grocery shopping.
You know, everything happens for a reason.
I'm just buying apples.
Commuting to work.
So when are you going to have a baby?
Watching TV.
We have to keep the Redskins' name. It's part of our culture and history.
Or just walking down the street with your partner.
I couldn't even tell you were gay.
Mosquitoes seem to pop up everywhere.
Do you know John? Give me shopping advice. I love Cher too.
And getting bit by mosquitoes every goddamn day.
Can I touch your hair?
Multiple times a day.
So pretty. Can I touch your hair? Can I touch it?
Is fucking annoying. That makes you want to go ballistic on those mosquitoes, which seems like a huge overreaction to people who only get bit every once in a while.
It's just a mosquito bite. Who cares?
Just another angry black woman.
Of course, beyond just being annoying, some mosquitoes carry truly threatening diseases that can mess up your life for years.
Astrophysics? Maybe you should try this challenging major.
Ow, my dreams.
And other mosquitoes carry strains that can even kill you.
You looked like he was up to trouble, okay? I felt threatened.
So next time you think someone's overreacting, just remember, some people experience mosquito bites all the time.
You're all so exotic, wow.
And by mosquito bites, we mean microaggressions.
Thank you. And then there's this comment in the chat. It says, the best analogy I saw, I don't know how to say the name, the first name. Miss Axon, do you know how to say the name? I don't want to say it wrong.
I think it's Igioma.
Okay. In the book, So You Want to Talk About Race, thank you. That if you are walking down the street and people keep hitting you in the arm, it's going to begin to hurt more and more and more. And even if they don't mean to hit you in the arm as you go by them, finally, someone's going to hit you in the arm, even accidentally, and you won't be able to take it anymore. You lash out. That person doesn't understand why you are lashing out. and when they just accidentally hit you in the arm, not knowing so many people have already hit you in the arm that day. Correct. Exactly. And that's what I love about this video, is that it really shows the, you know, the over time, how something as simple as a mosquito bite is not going to kill you, right? Even if you're allergic to mosquitoes, it probably is not going to do much damage. But if you're bit over and over and over, you know, eventually it becomes, the poison can kill you directly or indirectly. So same with the microaggressions and the things that we hear said on our campuses or at the grocery store or, you know, in songs, wherever, you know, that things that are said that maybe seemingly not a big deal, but over time can really have an impact. And then you combine that with any trauma or any mental health or any issues that the student maybe has in their own life that they're bringing into the classroom or grocery store or wherever. And this video to me really shows how it adds up and it becomes toxic.
And then you also have to think about it in the classroom. You know, in the high schools, kids have 6 classes a day. So that's 6 different environments, 6 different groups of people that they interact with. In the elementary school, you have 1 teacher, maybe 2, but the kids are confined with, say, 20 to 30 kids. And so they become like a family and it becomes regular. And so if also those same students are making comments and if it's not addressed, then it becomes that student's norm. And then they take that with them year after year after year. One of the sessions today was on trauma, being trauma-informed or having a trauma-informed classroom. And microaggressions can be a type of trauma that students experience. And if they don't find a safe space to have even conversations about it without having to react to it in order to protect themselves, that's where a lot of these behaviors manifest themselves later on. So I invite and encourage a lot of you, if you have young kids or young people that you interact with on the daily basis, if you see them having a bad day, sometimes just asking them what's going on, you could be that one adult that can help make a difference to stop some of the microaggressions that they're experiencing.
And we know that we can't change everything all at once. So really all we ask you to do after today's session or any sessions is really just reflect. And I know for myself, you know, Vera and I are both been a part of the unconscious bias workshop, and I learned something different every time about myself. So really just being willing to be self-reflective and not necessarily pointing the finger every time we hear microaggressions from other people, but making our conscious effort and changing our own behavior. And then being willing to talk in an appropriate manner to other people when we hear things incorrect.
Are there any questions or comments?
I have a question.
Yes, please.
How many teachers have learned about microaggressions, and what are we doing to inform students as well?
I think, and I could be wrong, Sue, is the number 600 staff that have been through the conscious unconscious bias?
I think it was somewhere between 500 and 600 when COVID started and kind of shut our workshops down.
And then after that, we've been doing our courageous conversations during COVID. And I would say each time we've had about 60. So I'd say easily about 300 to 400 have been through courageous conversations. So if you put those two numbers together, district-wide, only probably about between 600 and 700 have heard about microaggressions. And at the student level, unless one of our teachers has taken it back to the classroom as a conscious education team, we have not done lessons in the classroom on microaggressions.
However, when we finish the workshop, the 3-day workshop, that's one of the things people always ask for, is something tangible, like a lesson or something they can take away. And so one of the reasons that we wanted to have this mini session today is because this is a great starting place. So this, and I think in the last session, when we did this morning, somebody even said that this is a great starting place for counselors or teachers in the classroom.
So what do you think our next steps should be? What's our priority in your opinions?
Big question. We have a lot of priorities.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think the one thing that we have to understand is that, okay, so if you take conscious education, there's only about, the team is under 10, so expanding that, but then also infusing these topics in the curriculum as a whole. I mean, right now that isn't taking place, but that's one of the goals of ARC, to have curriculum that addresses this. And I think that's how we start to handle this on a systemic level, so that all kids are being exposed, but not only exposed, but this becomes the norm within the district.
Right. And then we also have to really create cultures with staff so that then we can bring that into the classroom. And then there's a couple comments in the chat. Priorities, create ongoing conversations, should be meeting all year on these topics. So maybe creating some safe places and safe spaces on campus where we can continue these conversations, not just with staff, but with students.
Mm-hmm. Because students have to feel empowered, not only like we talked about, to speak up about it so that they know it's wrong. If it's been happening to kids on and on and on, it becomes their norm. But if kids feel empowered to at least speak up about it, and then for the adults to be able to facilitate conversations about it and just say, oh, Johnny, brush it off. That's what happened to me when I was growing up. Not, okay, let's go have a conversation about the who, what, when, where, and why about it, but just brush it under the rug. I think that will also allow these kinds of things to reduce. I can't say they're not going to happen at all, but they will be identified, and we'll have strategic methods that are happening across the district to decrease them from happening.
It's kind of like having behavioral lessons that we used to implement within the district, like when we were doing PBIS. Mm-hmm. It's really starting with at its teacher level to introduce this to the students, because so many microaggressions happen on a daily basis with students that they don't know how to handle it, which can cause students to shut down. So does it need to be a priority? Yes.
And then there's a comment about culture education should be a year-round subject, not just one a month or one day talk. So correct, embedded in everything we do, not just in one chapter or in a section.
Right. And that's one of the goals of the ARC committee. And I mean, like we said, we didn't get here overnight, but having it from the top down, I think it will definitely happen faster, and it will be the status quo, so that if you aren't doing it, being called out on it won't be like, you're picking on me. It'll be like, you're not upholding what we believe as a district. And then, you know, you go from there.
And some of what we've been working on is creating opportunities for all students at within each of our sites for different things. So like Vera was saying earlier with the AP courses at the high school, like providing pathways for all students to get there, and, you know, educating people on who can and can't qualify, and just widening the pathways for our students. I think I just lost internet.
I can hear you. Okay, so we have two more videos. If there aren't any questions at this time, we're gonna move to, we have two more things to show you. Here's our contact information. If anyone here has any further questions, comments, or concerns, please feel free to reach out to myself or Sue. There's our number and our email address. The easiest way to get in touch with, I'd say myself, is email. But otherwise, you have our phone number. And Ms. Hunt will put that in the chat.
Yes, you want to go ahead and talk about the link that I just put in the chat?
Sure. They're going to have to either copy and paste it to make it a link, but we're asking for feedback on the presentation and for the equity conference as a whole. This is the first time that we've put something like this together. We've put a lot of hours into it, and we definitely want to make it better and something that could be ongoing each and every year. So your feedback is definitely appreciated, and we do take this information in order to make changes for the next time we do this. Okay.
Dear white teachers, and teachers of all colors for that matter.
Okay, we're just about done. Two short videos. And if you have last comments, go ahead and put them in the chat, and then we'll open it back up for any last minute comments.
Dear white teachers, and teachers of all colors for that matter, please learn to pronounce the names of your black and brown students correctly. You know, names like Florangel, Kervin, Fatimata, Binta, Elvin, Annabelis. Yeah, those names. We have at least three problems that occur when a teacher doesn't really pronounce the name of their student properly or doesn't really try and gives up on it. Number one, you create an environment where the student doesn't really feel comfortable because there's no trust. Would you trust someone who didn't pronounce your name properly? Probably not. So this is the environment that you're creating when you can't learn to pronounce their name properly, but yet you expect them to do everything you tell them to. Number two, you're not teaching them to have perseverance. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, what I mean is you're teaching them to give up. If you try pronouncing their name once and then said, you know what, I'm going to call you Betsy because Beatrice is too hard to say, what you're really telling your students right now is if it's too hard, then just change it. Number three, the last thing is common courtesy. I mean, my God, you wouldn't want someone to mispronounce your name, right? And if they did over and over and over again, what would you do?
You guys can call me Miss Stephanie. Can you say Miss Stephanie?
Estefani.
No, it's pronounced Stephanie.
Uh-huh, Estefani.
Stephanie, it's easy. Can you just say Stephanie? God.
Right, you wouldn't like it if it happened to you. So please learn to say their names properly. I guarantee you it'll go a long way in the classroom. If you don't know how to say their name, ask them. Ask them again. Ask them to say it slower. Ask them to say it in their native language and then spell it out phonetically in your attendance sheet. My God, we have a lot of other strategies of how to teach them, but why don't we have any strategies of learning as a teacher how to teach ourselves to better communicate with our students?
Okay, and then we're going to go right into our last video from Dr. Sweezy.
Thank you for attending Palm Springs Unified's first Equity Community Conference. And a big thank you to Ruby Rivera, the Family Engagement Center, district staff and volunteers from all across our district, as well as the Palm Springs Unified Anti-Racist Coalition. You were able to participate in some amazing sessions sponsored and hosted by district staff members and many of our important community equity work partners. I'm very proud to be able to continue to lead this work in Palm Springs Unified. We are at a very critical time for our district and, in fact, for our country. We will become an anti-racist organization that we are all so very, very proud of. Our school board supports the deep equity work and the honest conversations, much like what took place here today in this conference. We have an equity policy and clear, measurable objectives that we will report on publicly. Thank you for your commitment to this work. Thank you for being here on a Saturday. And I cannot wait to continue these conversations with all of you. Thank you.
Okay, so that is pretty much the end of our presentation. We thank you all for being here and for listening about microaggressions with us. Does anyone have any last words or thoughts? Anything that you discovered today that you're gonna use moving forward?
Thank you, ladies. Keep up the great work. You have my support 100%.
Thank you, Madame.
Take care. Have a good Saturday. We appreciate you coming out.
Thank you, everybody. Enjoy your day.
Good job, ladies. Good day, everybody.
Okay.
Hey.
Stop recording, Vera. Stop recording, Vera.